Tonight, the Call 6 investigators uncovered that it can be difficult and sometimes impossible to find out where your donated dollars are really going.
We found thousands of nonprofits across the country and in Indiana are misreporting how they solicit billions of dollars. Call 6 investigator Kara Kenny joins us. And Kara, this is all about knowing how effectively your money is being used.
It sure is, Jenna, and it may seem complicated, but stay with me. How much your favorite charity spends on fundraising can say a lot about the group and how it uses your donation. The issue here is what we found is hundreds of nonprofits in Indiana reporting zero fundraising expenses to the IRS. That means many groups say they don't spend a dime to make big money. Experts tell us that practice makes it hard to trust where your money is really going.
When you pull out your wallet to make a donation, you expect the charity to use it wisely. And you can check how the group is spending your money on its tax return, even how much it's spent on fundraising. At least you should be able to see that. But the Call 6 investigators and our partners at Scripps Howard News Service analyzed tax returns for charities nationwide and found 41% that raised at least $1 million report they didn't spend a penny on fundraising. Other groups spend extremely large percentages of their donations to raise more money, according to the data provided by the nonprofit oversight group GuideStar. Consumer experts recommend spending no more than 35% of contributions on fundraising, but Indiana tax returns show the Autism Spectrum Disorder Foundation in Schererville spent 47%. The Indiana State Fraternal Order of Police spent 75% on fundraising costs like mailings and this call center in Muncie. And Dogs Against Drugs, Dogs Against Crime spent 85% of contributions on fundraising, including payment to a call center in Tennessee. The Call 6 investigators found that charity has since folded. We tracked down the man in charge, former Anderson Police Chief Darren Sparks.
Your charity basically went under. What happened to it?
We didn't have any funding. The telemarketer that we used went out of business.
Okay, and so what ended up happening to people's donations?
People's donations. We didn't receive any donations after that, and if we received any, we mailed them back to them.
Sparks says his charity helped the community, but admits spending so much on fundraising was not ideal.
And we didn't like it. As a board of directors, we didn't like it, but if we just didn't have that contract, we would have had no money to be able to work with.
People need to check into a charity before opening their checkbook, according to the executive director at the Center on Philanthropy at Indiana University, Patrick Rooney.
So if donors ask tough questions, I think that's going to turn the tables and make them more responsive and more transparent about how much they're spending and how they're spending it.
The center published a 2004 study that exposed what it calls a concerning trend of charities reporting to the IRS they don't spend a dime on fundraising, despite bringing in millions. The Call 6 investigators found similar results.
It's a little disturbing that we see the same pattern.
722 nonprofits in Indiana collect $1 million or more each year. 45% reported zero fundraising expenses, a percentage slightly higher than the national average.
Why should that be a concern for the consumer?
I think it's a red flag that the charity is probably not being honest. It's a huge concern because it's a matter of misleading the public and misleading donors and misleading the government.
Do you feel like that's misleading at all?
No. I don't.
Susie Kemp with Bridges Community Services in Muncie reported zero fundraising expenses to the IRS despite bringing in $1.5 million, some from cash donations from individuals and businesses. Bridges provides housing services for homeless families and, including Kemp, has 14 paid employees.
What percent of your time do you feel is really spent on raising funds?
Less than, raising funds, including grants? Mm-hmm. That is my job.
The Center on Philanthropy at IU says anyone who spends time fundraising should allocate at least a share of their compensation as a fundraising cost.
I guess I want to say to the critics, it's not a black and white area, it's a gray area.
The Good Samaritan Network of Hamilton County also reported zero fundraising costs. This despite bringing in $2.8 million worth of donations like cash and canned goods.
Ours isn't misleading. Ours was actually zero. We did not solicit any funds. It's all donations that come in from our different events that people just know about us, and we've been around for so long.
Now, it's possible that a charity is being honest and they have they truly have zero fundraising costs. So, for example, they could have all of their fundraising being done by volunteers.
The Good Samaritan Network has more than 4,000 unpaid volunteers. Rooney says those kinds of nonprofits are the exception.
In the nonprofit sector, you have to spend money through fundraising to raise money.
With the economy still lagging, nonprofits are competing more than ever for charitable dollars. And that's why it's important for donors to demand accountability.
Ask those tough questions. Ask a board member, ask the CEO, what's going on here? This doesn't seem logical and doesn't seem plausible.
Some nonprofits told us they would re-examine their reporting procedures based on our findings. Others told us they have legitimate reasons for reporting zero fundraising costs.
Well, Carol, what about the groups that spend a high percentage on fundraising?
Well, the two in our story, the Indiana State FOP and the Autism Spectrum Disorder Foundation, they declined or did not respond to our request to meet and go over their fundraising costs. But we have a tool on our website if you want to check out your favorite charity at theindychannel.com.
I think I'm going to want to do that. Yeah. Kara, thank you very much.